Good morning, good morning. It's another first Sunday that the Lord has allowed us to come together. And we are so glad about it, amen. Amen. Because it's another day that God gave us health and strength. And I don't know about you, but I'm glad about it. I want to thank God today for the blood that he has shed for me. I'm reminded of the scripture, John 3:16, when it says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life." Anybody thankful for the blood this morning? I'm grateful that God shed his blood for me and for you. Are you glad about it this morning? Are you glad about the blood? Come on and join us for worship this morning as we get ready to praise God for whom all blessings flow. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
We at Noah's Ark, we just love to sing this song. Number 293, it says, "Father, I stretch my hands to thee, no other help I know. If thou withdraw thyself from me, or whether shall I go?" Let's sing with uplift his voices this morning, church. Father, sun endure before I drew my breath. What did I my soul from endless death?
Father, but we know that there's some that are sick among us, some that are dealing with physical issues, Father God. Some that are dealing with mental issues, Father. But Father, we know that you know all about it, Father. So Father, we pray that your will be done in the life of we, your people, Father God. And Father, when we can't do nothing that's on this side, when we have done all that we can do, Father God, we want you to know that there's no one greater than thou. And we say, Father God, let this mind that be in us, let it be as in your son Jesus. Father God, let this mind be in us, that everything that we say and do will be according to your will. Continue to watch over our leaders all over this land.
Yes, Lord.
Father God, we pray for their guidance. Pray that they'll look to you, Father. Look to the hills from which cometh their help.
Yes.
Father God, for we know that it's come from you.
Yes.
So, Father, we just pray for them, Father God.
Yes.
Father God, that mankind will turn from their wicked ways and seek your righteousness. But we know, Father, when we seek your righteousness, whatsoever we ask in the name of your son, Jesus, will be given unto us. So we come in Jesus' name, praying that your will be done in the life of we, your people, your children. For it's in his name. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Good morning, church. Everything that we do, and everything that we ask that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ don't do it without us.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Can we say that for ourselves, church? Can we say that for ourselves? Lord, whatever you do, still in the beauty of his holiness, though it be virtually. Amen. We're glad that you have joined us. And while you're watching, while you're joining us, make sure you push your button, the share button, that you can share with your friends, start a watch party, or whatever you need to do to make sure they hear this word today, that they can enjoy this service right there in their homes. We're here. Let me just remind you, first of all, that we want to be in prayer for all those persons that are being affected in our area and throughout the state of Georgia, amen, with this COVID-19, this pandemic that's going around. It seems that it's causing terror in our area and around us, but let's keep praying, amen. Let's be safe, let's mask up, amen, and stay out of those large gatherings. Next Sunday, we get back out on the lot. We have our parking lot church. We have a church on the lot, drive-in church. Amen. If you want to join us, we're at 4466 Georgia Highway 80 West here in Keysville, Georgia. You can join us on next Sunday at 8:45. Amen. Early service, 8:45, and join us for the drive-in church. Amen. You will be glad that you did, and you can get out of the house. Amen. And kind of just drive around and see some good old, see God's country out here in Keysville, Georgia. You can do that also. Let me just also remind all of us that are part of the church, and even those, some of you that have been watching us, you've been liberal in supporting us financially. I would just suggest that you keep doing that. We are so grateful to you for your financial support for the ministry here at the church. Ministry is going on. Amen. The doors are closed, but we're still trying to meet the needs of people in the community, and also those who are members of our church. We're doing in-reach and outreach here at our church, and we thank God for resources, and you are a part of that. And those of you that are members of our church, there are so many ways you can do that. Givelify.com, you can still do that. Cash App is $NAMBC4466. You can use the Cash App to do that while you're sitting there right now. And then not only that, you can either put it in the mail, the post office box, 536 in Waynesboro, Georgia. That's 30830. Or you can just do it in the mail. You can do it in the mail like that. You can do your online giving any way you can. We just appreciate the support that has been given and that which you are yet to give. Let's pray for our leaders, our governmental leaders. Pray that somehow we can get past party lines and racial lines, that decisions can be made for people. Let's pray that we can get through this if we can come together as God would have us to come together. And while we're here, and those of you that are about to make an offering, about to give an offering, about to write a check, about to do something on Givelify or whatever, let's just pray together for you. Amen. God, we thank you for the givers. We thank you for those who have the gift of giving, those who are giving beyond measure. God, we thank you that though for those who are giving not only their tithes, but they are giving offerings, making sure, God, that you are represented, your kingdom is represented in excellency in all that we do. We thank you for every hand, every heart. We thank you for every home that's giving today. We pray your blessings and your protection over them, even right now. God, you gave to us your only begotten Son, the greatest gift that we could have ever given. So what we do for you now, God, is simply because you have commanded us in your word to give a tithe and an offering. So bless them now is our prayer in a special way. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's prepare for preaching, if you will. Get ready for the word of God. There's a word that we want to share with you today, and it's going to come from Luke chapter 18. Luke chapter 18. We'll just look at those first eight verses. We'll try to get through them. May not get to verse 5, but whatever it is, we ask you just go ahead and turn your Bibles and your devices there. Minister Lane is going to come and prepare us, amen, for the preach word.
There's not a friend like the Lord, Jesus. No. No, not one. No, not one. Listen, Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide us to days are done. There's not a friend like the Lord, Jesus. No. God, does he to
God, we know that there is not a friend like you. Nobody can treat us like you treat us. Nobody can love us like you love us. And we honor you today. We reverence your name. We reverence your holiness, God. Thank you for being our friend. God, we thank you that we can humbly submit ourselves to you. You can look beyond our faults and see our needs. Now, God, there's a word that you left for us in your Bible. God, that we will open today, and we pray now that you would let the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, let it be acceptable in your sight. Use us for your glory. You are our strength and our redeemer. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. In your Bible, if you would turn with me, we could look at this together. Luke chapter 18, beginning with verse number 1, the Bible says these words. One day Jesus told his disciples a story to show that they should always pray and never give up. There was a judge in a certain city, he said, who neither feared God nor cared about people. A widow of that city came to him repeatedly saying, "Give me justice in this dispute with my enemy." The judge ignored her for a while, but finally he said to himself, "I don't fear God or care about people, but this woman is driving me crazy. I'm going to see that she gets justice because she is wearing me out with her constant requests." Then the Lord said, "Learn a lesson from this unjust judge. Even he rendered a just decision in the end. So don't you think God will surely give justice to his chosen people who cry out to him day and night? Will he keep putting them off? I tell you, he will grant justice to them quickly. But when the Son of Man returns, how many will he find on the earth who have faith?" Amen. I want to look at the text today, and I want to just kind of teach this and hopefully encourage those of you that are watching, those that you are listening. I would just want to talk about and remind you that persistence pays off. Amen. You ought to write that down over there in that column, in that little share thing, and just write that down. Persistence does pay off. Amen. Persistence pays off. One of the greatest privileges we have as believers and as Christians is something that we call prayer. Prayer is one of those graces that God has given us. And it is an amazing privilege of the believers that we have in our Heavenly Father, Jesus, who is our Christ. Yes, the God of the Bible does something. He invites us, the God of the Bible, the God that sits high and looks low. He invites us to talk to him in prayer. He invites us as children to speak, and he makes a promise that he will listen. He makes a promise that he'll listen. Jeremiah helps us with that in 29:12. Then the Bible says, "Then you will call on me," God is talking, "then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you." That's a promise from God that he will hear our prayers. Right. So simply put, prayer is this idea of believers or Christians. It's our means or our method of communicating with God. Why do we pray? We pray to praise God. We pray to thank God. We pray to make our requests known to God. We pray to seek God's wisdom and God's guidance. That's why we pray. We pray simply, sometimes we pray just simply to tell him how much we love him. We pray to get close to God. We pray because we draw nigh unto him. We enjoy his presence and tell him what is going on in our lives. We pray to God, and I read somewhere that the Bible says, in the Bible contains 650 prayers, but what's interesting about the Bible, of those 650 prayers, there were only 450 recorded answers to the prayer. He heard 650, but he answered 450. You might want to put a tag on that. But prayer, it's a major privilege, but our text suggests to us, beyond just a habit of a ritualistic habit of praying to God on a ritual basis, rather than that, he said a more powerful tool is not just praying, but a bigger issue is when we are persistent in our prayers. Persistence is this idea of what our foreparents did when they talked about, I'm just holding on. It's what they talk about when they say, sis, baby, you need to just hang in there. That's what they were talking about. Be persistent. They had one of David Dupree's quotes was always, a quitter never wins and a winner never quits. You can't give up. You got to hang in there. You got to be persistent in your prayer life. And that's what he said. And even the Bible suggests to us that we ought to be persistent. Galatians 6 and 9 suggests to us, it says, and let us not grow weary in well-doing. For in due season we will reap if we do not give up. We're not the people that want to give up. We're not the God that does not want us to give up or give in to situations. I like what Proverbs says about it. Proverbs 24:16 says, for the righteous fall 7 times and rise again. Amen. We might fall down, but we do know how to get up. Thank you, Donna McClurkin. We know how to fall down, but we know how to get back up. And I come to tell you this week, the life of persistent, the life of a very persistent leader was celebrated. Just this past week, we celebrated the life of Congressman John Lewis, who began his fight against injustice and racial equality. He's the son of sharecroppers in Troy, Alabama. He fought nonviolently for justice and freedom beginning in 1961, even until his recent death on July 17th. For almost 60 years, he consistently and persistently battled racism for civil rights. He is a model of what never giving up really means. He is an excellent model of never giving up on what he believed in. Even on the day of his funeral, a planned essay was released. And listen to what he had to say, what he wanted the believers to say. Did y'all know that he was a Baptist preacher, that he got a degree from the American Baptist Theological Seminary? But he had a thought in his mind all through his life. He was nonviolent. He wanted us to know something. Even on the day of his burial, look what he wanted us to know. It was released on the day of his burial. Here's a quote. He says, though I may not be here with you, I urge you to answer the highest calling of your heart and stand up for what you truly believe. In my life, he says, I have done all I can demonstrate that the way of peace, the way of love and nonviolence is the more excellent way. And look what he does. He hands off the baton and says, now it's your turn to let freedom ring. He was persistent in what he believed. He was consistent in what he believed. And just last week, they named the Civil Rights Bill after him. And there's a move even right now to add his name to the bridge where he was almost beaten to death in Selma, Alabama. I just want to let you know that persistence pays off. Persistence pays off. Jesus does something for us. He leaves us a parable. He leaves a parable for us that we can look at, that we can learn from, to remind us, yes, persistence does pay off. It tells us, it talks about a widow. The text talks about a widow who encounters an unjust judge and her persistence in her problem. It tells of this woman, this unnamed woman, this unnamed widow. It talks about her and her encounter with this unjust judge. But you got to understand, Luke talks about widows all throughout his writings. You ought to read the Bible. He talks about it in Luke 22:37. He talks about a widow in 4:25 and 7:11. And here in our text in chapter 21, he talks about widows because widows had a difficult time in making ends meet. So it was an excellent example for us to see what persistence really means. Now you got to dive into the text. You got to look at the text. You got to get into the Eastern culture and understand that the courtroom where she met the judge was not one of those downtown buildings like downtown Burke County, downtown Waynesboro, downtown Augusta, or Renz, or wherever. It wasn't one of those beautiful building marble palaces. The courtroom was actually a tent. And there were folk that could come by the tent and listen and watch from outside the tent. But nobody can go in the tent other than those who were appealing their case. And the judge was there. He was the law. He didn't interpret the law. He was the law. And you couldn't go in without approving. But there was some, he had some assistants around him. And the way you got in, you ended up having to bribe the assistants in order that the judge might hear your case. He was an unjust judge, so obviously he had some unjust assistants. This unnamed woman's claim was that she had been mistreated by her enemy. Her claim was that she's been mistreated by her adversaries, and she was seeking justice in the legal system. The widow had some obstacles that she had to overcome. Take note of this. She had some obstacles that she had to overcome. One of the obstacles that she had to overcome was the fact that she was a woman. The fact that she was a woman, even back then, women had little standing before the law. In the Palestinian society of the Lord today, women did not go to court. She had no voice. She was at a disadvantage simply because she was a woman. I could put a pin there and ride out there for a little while, but I'll move on. But understand that was one of her disadvantages, that she was a woman. The second disadvantage that she had was that she was a widow. She was without a husband. She had no husband to stand with her in court. And obviously, she didn't have a kinsman redeemer. But she was a woman, which was a disadvantage. She was a widow, which means she had a disadvantage. And then the final thing that she had, the other disadvantage that she had, was that she was without. She had no money. So she couldn't even pay a bribe if she could get to the system. And that explains why widows did not always get the best protection back in the Lord's day. It wasn't a lot of protection. Even now, we can see people that take advantage of widows, take advantage of those widows who are without husbands, without family. But basically what he was encouraging his disciples and us to do when it comes into this situation with this woman, this widow, is he says, you got to just pray and be persistent in your pursuits. And one of the realities of life, I can take that out of the text, one of the realities of life, if you're like me, there have been some times in your life when you prayed to God. You prayed to him at one time or another about some serious issues in your life. You prayed and you prayed, and God didn't seem to answer your prayer. I don't know what it was about. Could have been about some family issue, some medical condition, or something we really needed God to do for us. You prayed, and there were times you asked God in the spirit to answer your serious request because you were hoping that he would agree with you, that it would allow us to serve him better and be more effective. So you put that on the table and say, God, just do it for me this time. But it seemed that he wasn't hearing your prayer. But the question, here's the question. Here's the million-dollar question here. But the question is, what happens when God doesn't seem to answer your prayer? What's your response? What's your behavior when it seems that God has not answered your prayer? It's for that reason that Jesus tells the parable in the story of the persistent widow. That's why he tells this story, to help us, to help somebody that's watching Facebook today by answering that very question. And even if life's challenges, even in life's injustices, even in the underemployment, unemployment, in relationships, and even in our faith, this widow teaches us that we have to practice persistence. Because persistence does pay off. In other words, he says, when you pray, don't quit too soon. Don't stop praying. Keep on telling God about it. Jesus tells us precisely why he's sharing the parable. He says, you don't have to figure out while I'm teaching this parable. He says, look at it right there in verse 1. He says, I speak a parable unto them, and that men ought to always pray and not faint. He said, that's why I'm telling you this story, that you don't give up on your prayer life, that you don't give up on your persistence, that you persevere, that you endure through the situations, endure the hardships of a soldier. You got to be encouraged. In the Bible, he says that to show that they should always pray and never give up. I like this idea about giving up, because that little phrase, give up, it means that there's always a temptation to quit. Whenever you get tired and discouraged, there's a temptation to throw in the towel. And to be honest, in these past 5 months, there are times when most of us have gotten so discouraged that we didn't want to go to another Facebook church meeting. That some of us have gotten so discouraged that we didn't want to get on the conference call prayer line because we are discouraged with life around us. Things just don't seem right. Life is falling apart. But that's why we always will get discouraged in this sinful world because sin is around us. And where there is injustice, it will discourage you. Suffering and conflicts all around us, it will discourage you. When a neighboring young lady would drive in a pond of water with two 10-month-old children, you will get discouraged when a 21-year-old would ride down by the highway, park by park, and put a gun to his head. It will discourage you, and you wonder where God is. But God says you got to keep on praying and don't give up, because persistence does pay off. You have to resist and rebel against the urge to quit, the urge to hurt yourself, the urge to hurt someone else. You've got to hang in there and don't give up. You have to go back. And we look at this text. As we look at this text, it says, in a certain town there was a judge who neither feared God nor cared about people. That's in verse number 2 in the text. Now, that's really sounds something crazy for the judge to say that about himself. He says, I don't care nothing about, I don't fear God, and I don't care about me. He was an unjust leader, an ungodly leader. I ain't no prophet, but I don't want to go on Pennsylvania Avenue, but somebody got to get back to caring about people. This means that he neither had respect for God or the commands of God and had no compassion on people. And can I tell you, if a person don't love God, it's real difficult for them to love people. If they don't respect God, they won't respect people. That's why you ought to be careful who you hang around with, ungodly folk. If they don't respect God, they ain't gonna respect you. I'm not a marriage counselor, but I would tell you right now, if you're gonna marry somebody who don't respect God and they are ungodly, you would get yourself in a major mess. This man had no respect for God, and he didn't care about people. He was a jerk. He was a real piece of work. He would tweet stuff that didn't make no sense. And he had no compassion for people. He would not even show up at a civil rights or homegoing service. He would not even tweet any compassion to the family of a 60-year servant of God. He would not. He was an unjust man. Then Jesus says, and there was a widow in the town who kept coming to him. Hey, give me justice against my enemies, against my adversaries. She would wake up with him. She would follow him to the tent and says, I need some justice. She was stalking him to get justice. And I like that because she was persistent in her prayer. She was persistent in trying to get what she wanted. I like what the Bible says. You got to be careful how you treat the widows and the orphans. As a matter of fact, Exodus 22 says that you shall not afflict any widow or fatherless child. But the unjust judge had no concern for the dilemma of this poor woman. For some time, the Bible says he refused her over and over again. He ignored her, looked over her, just would not hear what she had to render justice in her case. But guess what she did? She kept on coming. She kept on coming. I mean, she was persistent, and she persevered long enough until the judge says, finally, he said to himself, he said, I don't fear God, I don't care about men, but because she kept on bothering me, because she's about to run me crazy, I'm going to see that she gets some justice. Yes, this woman was persistent. It's a lesson on being persistent and pursuing what you know is right. And when you are on the right side and God is on the right side with you, you can pursue justice. You can pursue what is right because God is with you. But you got to be persistent. You can't let up. You can't let your head down. And you got to be persistent in this fight for whatever you're fighting for. Don't just fight one time and give up. Keep on fighting. Keep on fighting, because when you read the text with a natural understanding, you'll believe, you'll come away believing that Jesus is teaching that we ought to wear God out in prayer. That ain't what this is about. It talks about the persistence of this woman in this judge. But what the Bible is doing here is literally comparing and contrasting God and the judge. And God is going to tell us in the text, he says, and will not God bring about justice for his chosen ones who cry out to him? In other words, he said, I'm not like that judge. He said, I will answer your prayer. I'll hear your prayer. I will not ignore my children. I like that because what it's reminding us of is that God will hear and answer our prayer. But I come to tell you today, my brothers and sisters, you have to agree with me that one of the biggest barriers to us praying is low self-esteem. We feel like God doesn't love us. We feel like that's something that, because God knows all about us, we won't pray to him. But I come to the best time to pray is when you're in a mess. A lot of us see ourselves like this helpless widow who had no power, no prominence, and no influence in high place. But the Bible says, but we ain't nothing like that. As a matter of fact, the Bible says we are more than that. We are more than conquerors to him that love us. We are more than some helpless widow, some helpless servant. We are more than that. We are holy and a royal priesthood. You are wonderfully made. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. So the lesson teaches us that a good reason to pray is because we are not helpless like that widow. That's why we ought to keep on praying. That's why we ought to keep on praying. And the Bible says you keep praying and it shall come to pass. Before they call, the Bible, God says, I will answer. And while they are yet speaking, I will hear their prayer. So what do I learn from the lesson? What do you learn from the lesson? From this persistence, knowing that persistence will pay off. The first thing you learn from this widow and this lesson is, the first thing you learn is that prayer exposes our need for God. Prayer, persistent prayer, exposes our need to God. Because listen, this woman, we don't know if she was like the woman with the issue of blood, but I would think that she's tried everything else. But she's come to this judge now because he was the only one that could help her. Persistent prayer reminds us that we need God on our side. It reminds us of our own limitations to solve our own problems. And there are some things, can I tell you, there are some things that only God can do. There are some problems that only God can solve. There are some issues in life that your money and your friends and your status downtown can't solve it for you. So sometimes you just got to call on God. So persistent prayer reminds us that it exposes us that we need God. And I don't know about y'all, but somebody in that room right now beside you can declare, I tried everything else, but I couldn't get no help. I looked all over, but I couldn't find nobody. But I need a savior. I like that because when the world all around us seemed to be sinking sand, you got to say, on Christ, the solid rock, I stand. When I need a savior, when I need a guide, where do you go? You don't go to the root worker. You don't go to the palm reader. You go to the rock of your salvation. I don't know about you. You need to remind folks, even in these times, when that seems like everybody got an answer, you need to know that we need God. You got to admit to God the weaknesses of your life. You got to admit to him, God, I can't handle this by myself. I'm about to lose, about to go out of my slapping mind. I'm about to do something crazy. But I need to remind myself that God is on my side. There are some problems that family and friends and even finances can't solve. But God can solve the problem. I need to tell some young people, you don't have to give up on life just because you don't have a job. Just hang on a little while longer and God will show you the way. We got to realize that only God can meet some of our needs. But we got to seek him and find him. And when we search for him, we need to search with all of our heart. The text says the woman didn't have nowhere else to go but to go to the unrighteous judge. But look what we have. We can go to the righteous judge, the one who knows, who sits high and he looks low. The prayer, persistent prayer, reminds us that we need God. But let me tell you one more thing. While you're thinking about praying, while you're thinking about giving up on God, or giving up on your prayer life, a delayed answer from God is designed for your good. I need to say that again. A delayed answer from God is a design, is designed for your good. I like this because it reminds us that sometimes when God hadn't answered your prayer, you need to sit around and don't try to rush God. Don't try to be God. And don't try to let nobody else play God. You got to wait on God. You got to be of good courage. And because sometimes we pray for some stuff that we really don't need. And even when we may think we do need it, how many prayers have you prayed? And looking back over your life, you glad that God didn't answer your prayer? Because you would have married the wrong person. You would have went to the wrong school. You would have got hired on the wrong job. But you waited on God. And look what God has done for you. He's got you right where he wants you. You got to know that God will answer prayer. But just because there's a delay in the answer doesn't mean that God doesn't care about you. It simply means he's designing the answer just for you. And what God has for you, it is just for you. I'm about to close my sermon because I'm getting a little too happy. But I think about the fact of old Elijah up on Mount Carmel when he called down fire from heaven. All of a sudden he called down fire and all the Baal's prophets were killed in fire, burning logs in water. But Elijah gets afraid and he runs and hides under a juniper tree and prays to God, God, I'm ready to die. God, come on and kill me. But God said, no, I ain't ready for that. So he tells Elijah, you just stay right there because I got something for you. So how did God answer Elijah's prayer? Elijah wanted deliverance right now, but look how God answered his prayer. God told Elijah, he said, I need you to go over there to Jehu, and who is the new king of Israel, and I want you to anoint Jehu. And Elijah said, no, why, God, why are you trying to tell me to do all of that? I'm concerned about Jezebel, and you telling me to go anoint Jehu. But he said, I'll do what you tell me to do. He goes and anoints Jehu. And y'all do know the rest of the story, because Jehu was the one that brought judgment on King Ahab and Jezebel. So sometimes God works through somebody else to get an answer to you. That's why you got to look for God for your deliverance. Prayer exposes our need for God. A delayed response from God is designed for your good. And I'm about to take my seat, but persistent prayer gives God time to answer your prayer in his own way. If you just hang in there and keep on praying, it gives God time to design your answer and answer it in his own way and in his own time. That's why your granddaddy said, he may not come when you want him, but he's always on time. But you gotta be persistent. You gotta keep on praying. You gotta keep on calling his name, because God always gives the best to those who leave the choice up to him. I like what Psalm 84:11 says. It says, no good thing will he withhold from them that walk upright. So keep on living right. Keep on praying right. And just hang on in there, because God, I said, he will answer your prayer. But you got to be persistent. You can't give up on praying. You got to pray in the morning. You got to pray in the noonday. You got to pray in the midnight hour. Whatever it takes, just cry out to him and say, Father, I stretch my hands to thee. There's no other help I know. If thou withdraw thyself from me, oh, whither shall I go? I said, you got to hang in there and keep on praying. Even when you're getting crucified, even when you're getting persecuted, you got to keep on praying. Come here, Jesus, while you're on that cross, I hear you praying. Say, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. I hear you, God. I hear you, Jesus, up on that cross, saying, I thirst. I hear you, Jesus, while you're on that cross, suffering. You're being persistent in your prayer. I hear you calling out to God, saying, Father, why hast thou forsaken me? I hear you praying that we ought to be like him, because sooner or later, on the other side of suffering, on the other side of persecution, on the other side of the cross, on the other side of your pain, on the other side of the pandemic, on the other side of the perplexity, on the other side of the problems, God is going to raise you up and answer your prayer just like the widow, because the widow got what she wanted. She got injustice because she was persistent. But look what Jesus got. Jesus got resurrection. He got up early one Sunday morning because he was persistent in his prayer. Persistence pays off. Don't give up. Don't throw in the towel. Might not have no money and no friends, no job, and no social status. But hang in there. God is still on the throne. Be persistent, because persistence does pay off.
We face many battles, but they're not yours. Word.
that he was going to suffer in a few days. He was going on the cross, but he had to go through some things, through some suffering. It's called the Passion Week. And because of this suffering, he says, what I want you to do is, I'm going to give you a piece of bread, and I'm going to bless it. I'm going to give you some fruit of the vine. I'm going to give you some wine. I'm going to bless it. But what I want you to do is, as often as you do this, he said, it will show forth your remembrance of my suffering. Listen, we are doing this virtually, and we would ask that if you're at home, and if you got whatever you got, if you don't have one of our containers, you didn't get by the church to get one, you can just pour you a glass of juice, get you a saltine cracker, Ritz cracker, whatever, because it's symbolic. What we believe is this is not actually the Lord's body, but this represents his body. So whatever you have in your hand, we're going to bless it right now, sanctify it for the purpose that we're using it for, that we can eat and drink together. And listen, while you're doing that, I want to just go to that little place over there while I'm doing this. Just punch that little side and say, so I have my bread, I have my wine, I have my substances. Just celebrate the fact that I'm in communion. I'm going to have communion with the believers today. It's precious. It is precious. So let's pray. God, we thank you for these substances. We thank you for how you have blessed them already, but we ask that you would bless them all over again. God, take them from this natural use, that it may have spiritual value, because of our understanding of what communion is all about. God, we can break bread together. We can eat together. Take it, God. Sanctify whatever's in the hands of the believer right now. Sanctify it for spiritual value. God, that when we eat and drink together, that it will remind us that we are one big happy family. But it reminds us of the suffering that you went through for us, simply that our sins may be forgiven. Thank you for being our God. Amen. So if you will, and we'll do this with you on Sunday morning since we're recording, take the bread and you go ahead and we'll eat together. Likewise, the fruit of the vine, we'll do the same thing. We'll drink together. Amen. So it ain't fake. It ain't performances. We're doing it together right here on this Sunday morning. And how precious it is that we can eat and drink together. And to God be the glory for all that he's doing for us, even at this time. It was the blood that never loses its power. And it gives us strength. Watch this. From day to day. And guess what? It'll never lose its power. It'll never lose its power.